saying hello from Bangalore. I'm at the Nalli corporate office with Lavanya Nalli, my guest for this show. I have been asking Lavanya for an interview for a long time now to understand how she retains the steel in the silks and to ask her what is the culture of Nalli, the 90-year-old legacy brand that she is vice chairperson of, beyond the decorative sarees that we see and we love and we buy.
There is a perception that women don't wear sarees anymore on a regular basis. But at the same time, I walk into a Nalli store or any other popular saree store and there's so many women just buying sarees for themselves. And the short answer to that is I think we're not one homogenous country anymore. The other question in terms of is it really waning? And what is, you know, what's the insight and how does Nalli sort of fare in that environment? The best way to answer it is with the data. Now, if anybody were to actually look into the sari industry is, depending on how you cut it, if you remove synthetic saris and, you know, the very low price power loom variants, could be around 40,000 crores. There is no brand which has even 10% market share or even 5% market share. So 40,000 crores, 10% is 4,000 crores, 1% is 400 crores. Show me one nationwide sari brand that has even 1% market share. Instead, what you have is a huge gamut of long tail, a lot of regional players. In that, Nalli is possibly the only national player. So we have that going for us, where we've got a national presence, national footprint. We've got our state close to our roots in terms of product is king. It's all about where we come from as a family, as a business family. We're all weavers and from the weaving community. And that is what we've stayed true to. And somehow we've grown, and with our successes, we've come to this. But nowhere near any kind of significant market share. All I'll say is I'm 35 plus. I won't say exactly how old I am. But I've seen in my lifetime possibly three major shifts. One, as a child and growing up in the business family, living in my ancestral home right on top of the flagship store. That India of 1980s and 1990s, where women wore saris out of a necessity. It was just a thing to do, out of protocol, out of custom, out of need, and they wore it every single day. Then I saw possibly the late 90s, early 2000s, where there was almost like a phase of rebellion. The mark of a progressive woman was to reject the sari. Women now, women who were born in, say, the mid 90s and after, or early 2000s, who are now reaching their 20s, they don't have any hang-ups about the sari. They never saw their mum being forced to wear a sari. They didn't really see it as a garment of patriarchy or any of that. For them, it's just, I choose to wear a sari. I get to wear a sari. And so I will take it out for a special occasion and I use it as an additional aspect to showcase my personality. And I bring it out and I wear it on the moments where I feel special. We're a family business and a business family at the heart of it. But we're actually not, we're not business family since forever. We actually come from the weaving community, the weavers at the heart of it. And then the, somewhere along the line that moved into business, and we've stayed connected to our roots and stayed connected to what we've been doing. And this is our own history, our own heritage. It's one of the great identity points that connects us as a family together. I suppose unspoken but very clear family values. Discretion is one of it, frugality is one of it, An example that I give is with CSR and philanthropy. My grandfather, who's now 82 and still in the family business, has been doing, he hit an age, I think in the late 70s, early 80s, where as per his mindset, he's reached that age where he said, you know, I joined the family business when I was 11, when my father passed away. At the age of 50, he was, you know, he was done marrying his last child. And then he said, everything now, I'm going to take into the, I used to put it back into the business for business expansion. Now I'm going to put it out into the community. And so he moved into this very clear phase of his life where he said it's going to be towards philanthropic efforts. And so the Carnatic music scene, Bharatanatyam, cultural arts in South India. No person, even if we are at the helm of it, can ever overshadow what the brand philosophy is about. The outcome that you see is more an outcome of our business actions, right? And what I mean by that is this. We do have training, but it's not the way that you would expect it at all. So for example, we have company values. There's no booklet. There's nothing written on a wall. But you ask any of the Nalli salespeople, you ask anybody, they'll probably rattle off four or five things which are consistent across the entire like 1,500 people that we employ. And they'll say things like, you know, like I said, like just be discreet, frugality, right? Let your actions do your work, right? Be an upstanding person, trust, like don't play with the customer's trust. You'll forego that one sale. It's not about that sale, but it's about be of service. So there's a lot of servant leadership, be of service, which is, I think, indoctrinated. One of the nice things that a family business does is I don't have quarterly earnings, I don't have quarterly targets. We set the goals. We have the luxury of being able to prioritize values over short-term growth targets and over sales targets. To me, modernity basically means that we're dynamic with, we evolve with the market. We evolve with the world, we evolve with the market. Back then in 1920s, we were the first, we weren't even a business back then. I mean, we were, like I said, a weaving family. So back then it would be, I think, my great grandfather. He took that call to say, you know, for the first time, we've got the possibility of using chemical dyes, which allows us to come up with very unusual colors, which are fast and it'll not rub off. And let's do it and let's try it. Now that was sacrilege for that time to say, how can you even think of putting chemicals on a silk and, you know, and but that was innovation for then, for 1920s. Right? And so I think that the way that any brand needs to endure is to understand where's the market today, where's the market going, how are we as a society evolving, and everything else will fall in place. So online was the one that I started when I rejoined the business 5 years ago. So that was back then when I came back into the family business because I was in the US and, you know, with Myntra and McKinsey and all of that. And my father basically said, this was 2016, I think, 16. And he said, it's such a discount driven. How can people buy saris without touch and feel? How will you take care of, like, you know, the double shaded saris? How can you show the sheen? If you do it in a flat lay, no one will understand it. And I said, okay, I understand everything. But it's an experiment, huh? Let me do. Right? What's the worst that could happen? And I did it the way that the family does it. Start small. And I had an internal metric to say, look, 3 years. It took us a little longer, took 3.5 years to break even, but then year four more than made up for it. Coincidentally, year four was when the pandemic hit. So I think that was also something that we saw. By the time the market had evolved, by the time we worked the kinks out of this new format, we got our hands around it and we figured out what works, what doesn't work, what our consumer likes, doesn't like. We, as a company, we went through this incredibly anomalous situation, right? Where for the first time in my life and in my father's life, we've confronted a situation where there's been no sales coming in. I think that was actually an opportunity for us all to come together and figure out what to do. And in that, there was a small shining hope, which was the e-commerce unit.